Hello, everyone. Welcome to the School of Intercession Global Ministry. I am Rasheda Davis, and I am teaching today. We are continuing our section on how to hear from God clearly, but we're going to have a subtopic on today. So I ask that you all share this broadcast because school is now in session. And I do apologize. The normal time is 2 p.m. Central, but today we're going to do it at 12:30 noontime. So I'm going to give you time to actually share the broadcast. And because we are doing school and training, I'm going to give you an opportunity to also get your notepads, your Bibles, and your pen and pencils. Yes, Lord. And we lift you high, Yahweh, Yahweh. And we lift you high. As we wait for everyone to tune in, I'm going to begin with prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we bless you, we honor you, O God, on this, O God, Sunday morning. Father, we bless you for who you are. You are Elohim. Father, we glorify you this morning. Father, we worship you. We adore you, O God. Father, we thank you, Lord God. Father, for all, God, that you have done. Father, all, God, that you're about to do. We thank you, God, for this set of time part, Father, in the name of Jesus. But, Father, God, even, oh, God, to repent of our sins. Father, I come in the name of Jesus. Father, God, I come, God, through the blood of the Lamb. And I ask, God, that you forgive me, oh, God, in the name of Jesus. Father God, for my sins, of my iniquities, oh God. Father, forgive me, God, for everything, God, that I have done, oh God. Father God, in this earth, Father, that is not like you. Father God, forgive me, God, of my sins, oh God, when I was not saved and yet, Father, being saved, oh God. God, I come before thee, God. And I come, God, confessing it unto you, oh God. And I ask, God, for your forgiveness. I ask you, O God, to wash me, O God. Father, to wash and cleanse, O God, the body of Christ. To purify us, O God, on the inside, O God. Father, that we, O God, can be carriers, God, of your glory. Andebo, meki andebo sha. Makande lo si andebo sha. Father, wash us, oh God. Wash your bride. Purify our hearts, oh God. Purify our motives, oh God. Father God, purify our sound. Ekiandebosha. Eandebo. Makandeloso. Ha! Makandeloso. Father, breathe upon us, oh God. We worship you, God. I worship you, Lord. I glorify your name. I glorify your name. There's no one like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Lord. Reset us, God. Reset our hearts, God. Bring back, Father, the love of God. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Thank you, God, for another opportunity, Father, to teach your word. Thank you, God, for another opportunity, God, to do your will. Oh, I bless you and I honor you, God. Just take a few moments. Take a few moments and begin to reflect on God. Begin to worship Him before we go into this teaching section. Oh God, I lift you high, God. Yega. Yega. Heavenly Father, and I ask God that you bless us, oh God. Father, as we enter, oh God, into your presence. Father God, into this teaching, oh God. Father, open up our hearts and our understanding, oh God. Father, bring about, Father God, fresh revelation and knowledge. Father, help us to apply this word on this day and forevermore. Father, we give you the glory. We give you the praise. And we give you honor, oh God. Yahweh, we give you glory. Yeshua, we give you glory. Ruach HaKodesh, we give you glory. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you get the glory from this teaching. You get the glory, oh God. Father God, from the depths of my soul, I glorify you, oh God. And I thank you, God, for ministering, oh God, to us through this teaching on today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you all so much for joining in. We normally start at 2 p.m. for the school and section. Today, I will be doing a teaching. I will be doing a teaching. The School of Intercession Global Ministry, it's not only a school, but it's also a church. So every other Sunday, we train in school, whether it's in intercession, prayer, the prophetic, the deliverance, or in worship. We train in the hour of school. So today is the school. So I'm glad you all join in. At this time, I want you guys to take a moment and get your Bibles, get your pens, get your pencils, and let's get ready to get equipped by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the teacher. I'm just the vessel that he chose to use this morning. So I want you all to get your notepads because we're about to dive into God's word. Now, we've been doing a teaching on how to hear from God clearly. We did the first class, the second class. This is going to be a 6 weeks training and teaching to equip God's people in how to hear from God clearly. If you miss 1 and 2 section, no worry. I will be putting both of those teachings into one, and I will actually upload that teaching on the YouTube channel for the School of Intercession. But today, also, we are continuing on how to hear from God clearly, but we're going to take a little time and going to do a subtopic that relates to that on how removing every hindrance that keep you from hearing God's voice. Now we're about to learn. Okay, we did part 1 and 2, and we learned some on how to hear God's voice clearly. Now we need to learn how to remove hindrance that's keeping us from hearing his voice, or hindrance that are things that hinder our prayers from being answered. So we're going to take a little time, and hopefully I will only do 6 points today because I don't want it to be very long. I want you to get enough, get in your spirit so you can begin to apply this to your daily life. And then the next time we meet for school in section, we can go over the other points, and then we will start back up in how to hear God clearly. Because in the previous other section, you're going to learn from 1 and 2 how to hear God clearly. And then you also going to learn to distinguish your voice from God's voice from the enemy's voice. So you're going to begin to learn the different ways that you can really discern whether you are hearing God's voice. But also, what is a very good point that you need to also learn, what hinders you, or what hinders us from hearing God's voice clearly. So I hope everybody got their notepad. So number one, this is about removing every hindrance. And we know hindrance are distractions, things that come to hinder us from hearing God's voice or our prayers from getting answered. Sometimes we wonder why this prayer is not getting answered. You're about to learn 6 powerful points today. Number one, I want you to write down sin, wickedness, disobedience, and iniquity in the heart. I'm going to read that again. I have scripture for every point that I'm giving you this morning. Sin, wickedness, disobedience, iniquities in the heart. This, number one, keeps you and me from hearing God's voice. Sin, wickedness, disobedient iniquities that's in the heart keep us from hearing God's voice. And I would like you all to share this broadcast with others that needs training on how to remove hindrance from hearing God's voice. Because when we're talking about prayer and when we're talking about intercession, we need to learn what actually hinder a intercessor from hearing God's voice, or any believer from hearing God's voice. So number one, again, is sin, wickedness, disobedient iniquity. Scripture for that, Isaiah 59:1-2. And we're going to go over that scripture today. Isaiah 59:1-2. This scripture is going to show us that this nothing make-believe, nothing made up. This is God's word speaking to us, his kingdom people. I want you to know that sin, wickedness, disobedience, and iniquity will hinder your prayers from getting answered. It will hinder it. It will put a stop from your prayers from being answered. And that it will also keep you from hearing God's voice effectively. Okay? So let's go to Isaiah 59, 1 and 2. I'm reading from the NIV version. The word of God says, surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save. Surely, Jesus Christ's arm is not too short that he cannot save, nor his ear too dull to hear. Nor his ear too dull to hear. So first, the word of God is telling us Jesus' arm is not too short that he can't save, that he can't save souls. Nor he having a hearing problem. His ear is not too dull that he cannot hear our petitions. His hearing, it's nothing wrong with Jesus' hearing, but he's going to tell you this is the problem. He said, but your iniquities, Rasheda, but your iniquities, body of Christ, have separated you from your God. Let me go back to that. He says, but your iniquities. So what are iniquities that have separated me? I'm going to use myself. That have separated me from my God. Here it is. An iniquity is sin. It's when I have missed the mark. When I have missed the mark. It is also guilt of iniquity. Iniquities is also evil. Iniquity is also faults. Iniquities is also punishment of iniquities. Iniquities is also mischiefs and wickedness. So God is saying to us, he said, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins, Rasheda, have hidden God's face from you. Then the word says, so that he will not hear. God saying, the reason why I cannot hear you is because you have a sin problem. I want y'all to keep this in mind. Sin, the sin assignment is to keep you separated from God. Now, those that just tuning in, we are doing part 3 on how to hear from God clearly. How to hear on God clearly. We're doing part 3. Now, in this section, we are learning how to remove hindrance that keep us from hearing God's voice or that hinder our prayers from being answered. And the very first point that God wants us to know, sin, iniquity, wickedness, and disobedience will keep our prayers from being answered. So if there are any sin, if there are any disobedience, if there are any iniquities, I just read you the word of God. God said again, surely the arm of the Lord is not too short that he can't save, nor is his ear too dull that he can't hear. He hear our petitions. He hear our cries. He hear our pleas. He says, so I do not have a hearing problem, Rasheda, but it's your iniquities. It's your sin. It's your wickedness. It is your disobedience that have separated you. Separate me, it have caused you to come apart from God. So remember, sin's job is to keep you detached from God, to separate you from God. That sin agenda is to defile you because God is holy. God is holy. So sin's agenda is to keep you separated from your God. So, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sin has hidden his face from you so that he would not hear. So that's the very first point. When there is a sin issue and we have not truly confessed that sin to God and given it to God, God said, until you get that right before me, I will not hear your prayer. I will not hear your petition. He said, it's not that my ear is dull. It's because sin is the blockage. Sin is the issue. You have allowed sin to come in between me and your relationship. Do y'all hear me? You have allowed sin to step in between me and your relationship, just like in a marriage. Don't allow others to step between you and your spouse relationship. God said, I would not hear. Let's go to point number two. So we're learning things that hinder us from getting our prayers answered. So number two, second point I want you to write down. We are in school, so I ask that you please take notes. Number two, unconfessed sin. And we just talked about sin, wickedness, disobedience, and iniquity. Now, number two says unconfessed sin. Unconfessed sin will keep your prayers from being answered. Unconfessed sin. Proverbs, write down Proverbs 28 and 13. Proverbs 28 and 13. Unconfessed sins will keep your prayers from getting answered and will hinder you from hearing God's voice. It would hinder you from hearing God's voice. So I'm reading again at the NIV version. It says, he who conceals his sins does not prosper. But whoever confesses and renounces them will find mercy. I'm going to read that again and explain it. He who conceals his sin does not prosper. So if we conceal our sin, we will not prosper. And what does conceal mean? Conceal means if we cover our sin. If we cover our sin, God said we will not prosper. So what that means, we won't prosper. That means we will not advance. We will not advance. We will not make progress. And we will not succeed when we cover sin. That's the word. That is God talking to his church. So God is telling us, okay, I want you to remove the blockage. And when I reveal to you, Rasheda Davis, that there is a blockage in you, I need you to confess it. I don't need you to conceal it. I don't need you to try to cover it up because I already know it's there. But I need you to uncover, agree with me, because God wants me to prosper. He said, but if you cover your sin, if you don't admit that you're wrong, if you don't admit that you was walking in pride, if you don't admit that you need to apologize to your spouse, if you don't admit that you need to go back and make it right with one of your friends, one of your relatives, if you continue to try to cover your sin, you will not prosper, says God. You will not be a prosperous intercessor. You will not be a profitable evangelist, prophet, teacher, a believer in the kingdom of God. Gifts and calling come without repentance. You can be gifted, and in God's eyes, if you are covering your sin, you will not prosper. You will not prosper, says God. But he says, but whoever confesses and renounces sin will find mercy. Now, when we confess, let me talk about confession a minute. When we confess sin, we got to confess with the motive to throw it away. We can't just confess something and not have the motive to walk upright. That's why confession and repentance needs to work hand in hand. Let me give you a definition of confession. Let me give you a definition of confession. To confess means I'm going to acknowledge or profess my sins before God. I'm going to agree with God. God, you're right. You're right about me in that area. I'm going to acknowledge it. I'm going to make a confession that's made. And also, confession is to admit, mean to agree, to declare myself guilty. I declare myself guilty of what I've been accused of. And I'm going to tell you why this is so important. Let me tell you why it's so important to agree with the Holy Ghost. It's because we have an accuser of the brethren. We got an accuser. There is an enemy. There is an enemy, and he is ready to take your unconfessed stuff before the throne. And you go, heki andebo, she andebo, so ya mandedo, see all in the throne of God. And the enemy standing there, hey, I got a case against her. I got a case against her. Let me present you this case. I'm going to take you to the word. The word says in Revelation 12 and 10, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down. Who accused them? Who is the devil accusing? The sons of God, the believers in the kingdom. He is accusing us before our God day and night. This is one of his assignments. To bring false accusations and to bring even accusation if we're not in a position where we have turned and repented to the Lord. He's bringing those accusations before God. But once you confess it and repent, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. Because now my vessel is in right standing with me. Amen. So unconfessed sin, be careful of unconfessed sin. Confess your sins to the Lord. I'm going to read that again. And then I'm going to explain what renounce sin means. He who conceals or cover his sin does not prosper. Mean you will not make progress. You will not advance. You will not be successful. You will not exceed if you cover your sins. But whoever confesses and renounces them will find mercy. Now, what does it mean? We understand what it means to confess, to admit your wrong, to confess that, make that confession from your heart. Yes, God, I'm wrong. I'm wrong about that. Make that confession from your heart and renounce them. And the Bible said, if you confess it and you renounce the sin, God said, I will grant you mercy. Now, renounce means when I renounce a sin, I am giving up the sin. I am to refuse to follow and obey that particular sin. So when we renounce sin, that means we give it up. That means we let it go. We're not just confessing it with our lips, but our heart is also in agreement and our actions is to give it up, to refuse to follow or obey. That's simple as that. Renounce the sin. If you confess and renounce the sin, the word of God said we will find mercy. And what does mercy mean? That means God going to show us some compassion. He's going to show us compassion. He's going to show us compassion. Now I'm going to give you another scripture on unconfessed sin. Why this is so important and why this right here can hinder our prayer walk. It can hinder our growth in God. It can hinder us being an effective intercessor. It can hinder us from hearing the voice of God clearly when there is a sin blockage. Let me give you another scripture, Matthew 5 and 23 through 25. Matthew 5, 23 through 25. It says, if you, Rasheda, I'm going to use myself. If you, Rasheda, are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, God is instructing me. I'm at the altar. I'm about to offer my gift to him. My gift of worship, My gift of prayers and intercession, my gifts of tithes and offering is probably what this scripture was mostly relating to. But whatever offering, gift, I'm about to present to God at his altar, at the altar of heaven, he said, and if God bring back to my remembrance that my brother and our sister have something against me, he instructs me, Rasheda, daughter, I want you to leave your gift here in front of the altar. Leave your gift here. That's why I think it really was relating to some type of financial gift or offering. Because he said, leave the gift there in front of the altar. And I also like to present it too, even in gifts of praying, whatever God. And if there is some type of sin or offense that haven't been dealt with, go deal with that first. So when you present your offering before the Lord, it won't be hindered. It won't be hindered. It'll be coming out of a clean vessel that is now in right standing with God and with his scripture. Leave your gift there in front of the altar. He said, this is what you need to do first. The scripture said first. First go and be reconciled to them. Then, once you are reconciled, in other words, go make right what is wrong. Go make it right. First do that. Then come and offer your gift. Then come offer your gift. When I go back and make what is wrong right in the eyesight of God, according to the scripture, then he said, come and offer your gift. When you are on the way to court with your adversary, settle your differences quickly. Settle it quickly. The adversary desires to deliver you to the judge, as the scripture continues. And that what brought me to Revelation 12 and 10. We have an accuser of the brethren. He is cast down, but he is ready to accuse us before God day and night. The enemy is always bringing charges of our sinful behavior against us before God day and night. The enemy has been cast down. He's been thrown down. He can never go back to that position. And guess what? He's on an assignment. He's on an assignment to make sure that none of us, nobody in the world, his job, nobody in the world, he don't want to be in that position with King Jesus for all eternity. Because he know he'll never get that opportunity again. He will never have the opportunity to repent. He will never have the opportunity to confess. He will never have that opportunity anymore. He's been cast down. He's been thrown down. So he will try to bring up before God false accusations, and he will try to bring up accusations that when we haven't done what the word say do. Y'all know the enemy know the word. He was quoting Jesus' scriptures. So we have to make sure that if we don't want our prayers hindered or to keep us from hearing effectively from the Lord, we got to get rid of sin, wickedness, disobedience, iniquities, according to Isaiah 59, 1 and 2. Also, unconfessed sins, Proverbs 28 and 13. I have more scriptures on these, but I'm only going to give you one today on each one. Also, confess your sins and don't leave them unconfessed. Confess, guys. Confess your sins. Do not leave sins unconfessed. I have prayed prayers and I have asked God, God, forgive me for sins. Going back to Adam and Eve, I have asked for generational sins to be removed from my bloodline. Father, forgive me for every sin that I have committed since I've been in the earth. Father, sins I may have forgotten about. Father God, please forgive me, God. So you want to make sure you leave no room for the enemy to bring false accusation. And I'm not saying this just praying it and saying it religiously. I'm talking about having a reverence for God, fearing God, respecting God, and want to be in alignment with God. You want to release it from that position. You don't want to just release it being religious. Well, I did that part. No. God is a heart reader. He's a discerner of the heart, which we're going to get down to. So also confess your sin and don't leave them unconfessed. James 5:16 says, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayers of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And some versions says that the prayers of the righteous avail as much. Now, let us explain this. Holy Spirit, explain this to us. Now, God wants us to confess our sins and don't leave nothing unconfessed, because we want our prayers answered, especially in this global reset. You know, we're in a global reset where God is dealing with the world, not just the church. He's dealing with the whole world. He's dealing with government mountain, education, religion, family, meters and entertainment. God is dealing with the whole world. And he wants us back in alignment to his agenda and to his will. He wants us all back in alignment. So he wants us, the church, to be in a position where we can pray and intercede. But we got to make sure that our prayers and our intercession will hit the target. Now, if we got unconfessed sin, we got people we don't like, and we got disobedience in our heart, how the prayers are going to be answered. So that's why we got to be taught on this. And we got to be retrained out of this religious mindset. Out of this religious mindset that I just offer up something to God and that's it. That's why after we do how to hear from God clearly, we're going to do a teaching on the tabernacle. And we're going to learn the proper pattern, how to get into the presence of God, how to hear from God. Amen. So we're going to go to this next after we get through with how to hear from God clearly. So this is a global reset for the world. He's calling us all back into his order. So let me explain James 5:16 through the Holy Ghost. He said, therefore, confess your sins to one another. Word of wisdom. This doesn't mean that you get on the phone and you go call everybody and tell them everything you done wrong. This doesn't mean that you get on the phone and you go tell the close sister or brother in Christ. No. What this scripture means, and the other scriptures we read, that your sin have separated you from your God. And God said, I will not hear you because of sin, because sin assignment is to separate you from God. So you'll confess those sins to God. There are also times where it is okay when you're led by the Holy Spirit to go confess your sin to a brother or sister in the Lord, that the Lord has led you to speak with. And words of wisdom, this person needs to be mature in the Lord. This doesn't need to be a baby in Christ. This does not need to be somebody that is self-righteous. This does not need to be somebody that's full of themselves. You have to make sure that if the Lord is leading you to confess sins to a individual, that the Holy Spirit will appoint the person to release this to. Because this is what the word says. Confess your sins to each other and if you go and you confess your sins, it said confess to one another. So we ain't got room to find fault. We stick with the word. Now it's okay to correct one another in the word, long as in love, you in the word of God. But then this is what the next thing says do. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other. So the reason why we confessing our sins to one another, is so we are making a confession to one another, and God in our presence, he hear the confession. Listen, not being religious, it's coming from the heart. It's a pure place. I got to release this. Can I talk to you? It's some things that I need to confess and get right before God. And even if you go into that person that you may have offended, I need to get this right before you. I have done wrong. I have did this against you. And that person may say, you know what? I need to repent to you too. I need to confess some things to you. I have not done right by you. Please forgive me. Now the purpose of this, don't you see, even in that example, how much glory God would get? Because we obeying what he said do. Do you see how much glory? But the enemy will step in and say, keep that sin covered. Because he don't want you to prosper. He don't want me to prosper. He would keep on telling us, submit to pride. Now be private. Don't admit what you just let her say something. And you know, you need to confess to. Just let her say it. Just let her speak. Yeah, God, I'm glad you dealt with her. I'm glad you dealt with him. Confess to one another. And after we confess, we are admitting before God. And to the person, or even if it wasn't a personal sin to that person, you just want to release some things out. You are admitting that you are wrong. You are confessing from the heart. This is nothing religious. This is something that Holy Spirit has prompted on you to do because you want to be right before God and you want your prayers to be effective and powerful before Yahweh. So he said, once I do that, he said, then we are to pray for one another. So God gets glory when we obey the word. We confess the sin. We're both godly sorrow. We're both the individual. Now we're about to pray for one another that we will come back in alignment with God. We were repented of our sin. We have met God's standards so we can receive our forgiveness and healing. We have met his standards through his word. Then it says the reason why we're going to pray so that we may be healed. So when we pray in that condition of our heart, of true confession, a true repentance, guess what's happened? The king will manifest the kingdom. And we will receive our healing that we need. The King, King Jesus, will manifest his word. His word will not return to him void. His word going to accomplish and do what it is sent to do. And that is to bring healing, restoration, or whatever is needed for what we're confessing of. This is what the scripture says. Confess your sins to each other. Pray for each other so that you may be healed. Now we know that verse particularly was talking about people that need some type of physical healing. But also people also need emotional healing. People need healing in the mind. So we can also pray for them to be healed also mentally, not only physically, amen, but also emotionally. Sometimes people just need to confess what they emotionally going through. They know the word, but they just need to confess it. And they need some prayers that's going to manifest healing. They need prayers that's going to manifest healing. The prayers of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The prayers of the righteous availeth much. Now, what is a righteous person? I want y'all to write this down. What is a righteous person? A righteous person means that this person has been made right with God. This person is looked upon as innocent. This person has been declared holy. Now let me explain something. They have not been made right with God based on their own righteousness. They have not been looked upon in the eyesight of God as holy and innocent because of their own actions. That's not what God means. Because our righteousness, our own righteousness, our own good deeds is nothing but filthy rags. We are made right with God through the blood of his son, Jesus Christ. We're made right through Jesus Christ. His blood declares us righteous and it has made us whole. Also in my book, Keys to Open the Heavens, I have a whole section on how the blood has justified us, how the blood has purified us, sanctified us, made us whole. It's through the blood of Jesus. But God does not want us to treat the blood as an unholy thing. You know, some people can become very religious and they can call on the blood. Well, I'm holy because of the blood. And they keep on trying to trample in the blood and treat it like an unholy thing. Don't play with the blood. God don't want us to take the word of God and make it religious or to fit it around how we think and around our own imaginations. That's why we need clarity. That's why we need to be taught how to apply the word to our lives. But this person has been made right with God, looked upon as innocent, holy, just before God, upright. They keep the commands of God. Listen, with the help of the Holy Spirit, they keep the commands of God with the help of the Holy Spirit that when they miss the mark, when, not if, but when they miss the mark, or when I miss the mark, I can go back to the Father in Jesus' name, not out of being religious, just saying stuff, not being religious, but from my heart. God, I confess this sin to you. God, I was wrong. God, could you please forgive me? Could you wash me in your blood? And guess what? It's done. It's done. It's done. I'm going to take you to the scripture to back that also up. Also, a righteous person is faultless, guiltless. They're being conformed to the will of God. So the prayers of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The prayers of a righteous person is powerful and effective. This righteous person, again, is not righteousness in self, not self-righteousness, not walking in the spirit of the Pharisees and Sadducees spirit. So that's not what this scripture is talking about. Not self-righteousness. Self is not their God. That person's prayer is powerful and effective. Now, when it says that this person's prayer is powerful, this righteous person that's been made right with God in God's eyesight according to his word and according to his standard, that person's prayer is powerful. Meaning, that person's prayer is a force. That person's prayer has power over whatever you are praying about or against. Why? Because this individual has been made right with God. If they sin, they have got back in alignment with God. You know, sometimes the enemy can begin to torment people's mind. Torment them and think they have to do so many other things. And God just said, just confess and repent. Let me take you to the next scripture. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Right here through confession, true repentance, true confession. God said through your sincere confession, not through a religious confession, because some people will confess, God, I did A, B, C, and D. I cheated on my spouse. I fornicated. I did all of these things. And guess what? They just speaking that religiously, because out of the same mouth they speaking, their heart is saying it at 7 o'clock tonight is on. So they're doing, it's like having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Well, it's like having a form. So we don't want to have a form of godliness. We want to make sure that our confessions are really sincere. And we do know that some people that are struggling, they are struggling and they're really, really, really trying to get free from some things. And those incidents, those people have to cry out to God, because if it's really sincere and that person really do want to change, God will give you discernment. That particular person needs to cry out for God for deliverance. There is a struggle there. And they need sincere deliverance. And that's why when these souls come and confess those sins to God, or if they're led to come to an individual, the gift of discernment is very, very key. It's very, very key. So we got to just make sure God just looking at the heart. Because remember, he's a heart reader. He know the intent and the motive of the heart. So if we confess our sin, he was faithful and just and will forgive us our sin and purify us from all righteousness. So through our sincere confession, we can be forgiven of sin. And we can be purified from all, not some, but from all unrighteousness. So we want to make sure we're not concealing our sin, not trying to cover up our sins or make excuses for our sins. So what I'm saying is, always discern your own heart. Always discern my own heart. Number three, the third point in how our prayers can be hindered from getting answered or keep us from hearing God's voice. Number three, when we deliberately sinning with no true repentance. I want y'all to write that down. Deliberately sinning with no true repentance. And this is go back to the example I said before, because we can have some people that can just confess stuff and just use 1 John 1:9 religiously. Y'all, it's just true. It's just true. We have people that religiously will use 1 John and tell you, don't judge me. Don't judge me. No, an individual is not judging you. I'm using this in this example. We know some people does judge, but I'm saying when an individual is really not judging you, it's the word of God that really shows us up. And the word of God is judging us, the wrong that we're doing. When we try, or when I try to use a scripture to back up what I am doing wrong. So, deliberately sinning with no true repentance. Hebrews 10:26. If we deliberately keep on sinning, what does deliver mean? Voluntarily and willingly. Because God gave us all a free will. If we deliberately, voluntarily, willingly keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth. After we have received the knowledge of the truth, these are believers. After we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sin is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Again, if I deliberately, willingly, voluntarily keep on sinning, keep on cheating on my husband, keep on lusting after other men, keep on lying, function in the spirit of lying, if I keep on sinning and try to keep using 1 John 1:9, where I confess my sin, he is faithful and just to forgive me. He gonna purify me on my righteousness. See, I'm forgiven. So we just got to make sure we're not trying to manipulate the word of God or try to manipulate God. We already know he can't be manipulated. He already know what we're going to say even before we see it. So what God is just trying to teach us in this, that when we confess, God looks beyond our lips. He's looking at the intent of our heart. That's all God is saying. He's really looking at the intent of our heart. He knows within, when we release it out of our mouth, if on inside of us, deep within us, that we already are in position and have that heart to repent and change, because he gonna help us. He's gonna help us. But he also know when we are functioning in a form of godliness. He also know when we are trying to justify our sins based on one particular scripture that we hold on to. But we got to remember all the other scriptures to get the full picture of what God is saying to us personally. We want to make sure we rightly dividing the word of truth. We want to make sure that we ourselves as believers are not functioning as hypocrites, that we too as believers not functioning as in spirits of importance, our spirits of hypocrites, of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And we want to make sure we are functioning in the spirit and that we are releasing and operating in the spirit of God as he would. Amen. So we don't want to be deliberately sinning with no true repentance. So if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, the truth about the Son of God, facts about the kingdom, we have received precise and correct knowledge about the kingdom of heaven. God said no sacrifice for sin is left. The Father said, hey, I sent my Son. He offered himself up for all of your sins. But if you deliberately keep on sinning, trampling in the blood, treating it like it's unholy, and there's no sacrifice for sin for you left. He said, but only, this is what's left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment. Not judgment from man, but judgment and of rage and fire. Because I'm going to tell you the difference is being a believer and a saint. A believer, a true believer in Christ, practice living the word of God, even when we sin, even when we miss the mark. They practice holiness. And holiness is, let me explain holiness to you. There's a scripture that said, be ye holy, for I am holy. God would not tell you and I to be holy if he did not give us the ability to be like him, to be holy. When God say, be ye holy, for I am holy, and he said, listen, without holiness, no one will even see the Lord. No one will see him unless we are practicing a lifestyle of holiness. Because remember, God is holy. And that's why he gave us the third person of the Godhead as a gift to us to help us to walk in holiness. He gave us Holy Spirit. And his name is holy because he's holy. Spirit. Holy Spirit. There's a lot of spirits in the earth. Evil spirits, spirits of procrastination, spirits of anger, spirits of the Sadducees, spirits of rage, spirits of murder, python spirits, marine spirits. There's all type of spirits in the world, but those are evil spirits. But God's spirit is holy. And And when he say, be ye holy, he has gave us the Holy One to come down here, live inside of our spirit. And as we yield to Holy Spirit, and as we yield to Holy Spirit, he come to purify our minds until it becomes like Christ. It's a yield. Remember, God gave us a free will. So holiness is dealing with purity. Purity. The things I say, are they holy? Are they pure? Are they clean? Another definition of holiness is separated from evil. We all know what evil is, because we all undone some evil things. We all familiar with what evil is. So we can't say we don't know what holiness is. Holiness is the opposite of evil. Holiness is opposite of evil. So God, through his Holy Spirit, his Holy Spirit is our helper. His Holy Spirit is our teacher. That's why we can grieve the Holy Spirit, because he lives inside of us. Everything in him is upright. Everything in him is like God. Everything is in him comes from a pure place. So when he corrects us, we can feel when we grieve in God. God just saying yield. Because if you're going to be holy, that means you're practicing. You live a lifestyle of yielding to the Holy Spirit. You're staying in alignment with him, not in alignment to your flesh. That's why God tells us every day, deny yourself. He tells us to crucify our flesh daily. That means that we all must learn how to destroy the flesh power. Because the flesh got power. Just like the Holy Ghost got power. The flesh got power if you give it to him. When you give it to him. So when God say be holy, he's talking about be pure. Be upright. Separate yourself from evil. Let me go to this right here. I'm going to give you another one. And we're going to jump right back to this. For some reason, the Lord wanted me to talk a little bit about holiness. Because we hear a lot of people say, be holy. Without holiness, no one will see God. But what is holiness? So holiness is to function. You are functioning in the Spirit of God, in the mind of God. You are separating yourself from sin, or the sin nature, or from your sin nature. There is a nature that loves to sin. You can read Romans, the 8th chapter. That's why it talks about life in the Spirit. It's talking about life in the Holy Spirit, life in purity, life in holiness, life without darkness. But God knows we're going to miss the mark. But the key thing is, are you going to make excuses for missing the mark? Are you going to confess it? You going to make excuses? Or is I'm going to confess? And is I'm going to repent? Or will I voluntarily and deliberately keep on sending? That is the ultimate question. That God look at lifestyle. Sinners do what? Sinners sin. They practice sinning. Believers are Christian, supposed to be practicing holiness. Not without God's help though. Because you can become performing based or become self-righteousness. You're trying to do it on your own. No, we need help to live holy. We need help to turn the other cheek, don't we? We sure do. We need help to pray God's perfect will. We need help. And we have a pure helper, guys. Somebody that's pure. Somebody that's holy. Somebody that don't do nothing wrong in God's eyesight. Somebody, check this out. Somebody that won't say nothing without he hearing what the Son and the Father says. That's who live inside of us. The Holy Ghost. He's not going to say nothing. He's not going to say a word that's going to hinder you from going outside the Father's will. He's always in alignment with truth. He's always in alignment with right. So what the Holy Spirit does, if we're going to practice holiness, when we mess up, it's not an if, because we will. Because we will mess up. We will. We will not always hit everything on the dot. But when we mess up, will you practice holiness? Will you come back in alignment with Holy Spirit? Will you agree with Holy Spirit and he say, you need to go back and apologize to Sister Tasha? You need to go call your relative. You need to do this or you need to do that. You need to go and get it back right with your spouse. See, that's a person practicing walking upright before God. You're not being religious. You're not going to wait to go to church Sunday and now I'm going to quote 17 scriptures and you don't even live it. No, that's a form of godliness. So I wanted to make sure we understood when God is telling us to confess our sins, to make sure we're not confessing and still voluntarily sinning. We just confessing. Because see, I did that when I was a teenager, a young adult. It was religious for me to go to church, but not walk out the word, not even attempt to walk the word. That was a normal lifestyle for me. So we really do have a lot of people really think they in scripture with the Lord because they know this particular scripture. But their lifestyle is opposite of that. And they wonder why their prayers are being hindered. And wonder why. So I pray that is understood in a way that we can all understand. So we will know how to walk in Christ, to walk in him, to walk in his spirit with the help of the spirit, because we cannot live and walk this walk without the Holy Spirit help. If you try it on your own, you're going to frustrate yourself. If you try it on your own, you're going to be in your own strength. I did that and done that, and it wears you out. The key to walking with God is yielding to Holy Spirit. Is yielding. Even when you don't want it, you just yield. Because you want to be in alignment with heaven. Your heart is so connected to the heartbeat of Yeshua, Jesus the Christ. You just want to be one with him. You want to please him. You make it not about you. You deny yourself and you take up your cross and you follow him. You follow his word. So I wanted to make sure we know that, because this is scripture, Hebrews 10:26. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we receive the knowledge of truth, no sacrifice is left. There's only judgment. It's not man judging us. Our actions bring about our own judgment. Our actions. We become an enemy of God when we deliberately keep on sinning. So we become an enemy of God if we keep on sinning. Now, the fourth point, removing every hindrance that keep us from hearing from God's voice or that hinder us from getting our prayers answered. This is our fourth point. Now, we done dealt with different levels of sin. We done talked about that. We're only going to do 6 points today. So we're on number four. Our fourth point. How can our prayers not get answered? Number four, when we function in doubt and unbelief. I need y'all to write this one down because this is one other big one. Unconfessed sin was one big one. And number four is doubt and unbelief. Let's go to James 1 6 through 8. You can write that down. James 1, 6 through 8. Doubt and unbelief can hinder our prayers. But when he acts, he must believe and not doubt. I'm going to say that one more time. But when Rasheda acts, she must do what? If I'm going to ask God for something, God said, I must believe and not doubt. Because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That man or woman should not think he or she will receive anything from the Lord. He is double-minded. He's a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. Now let's go over this scripture. Write that down. My prayers can be hindered if I doubt and I function in unbelief. Let's break it down. Okay. I got a request before God. I'm asking God for something. I'm petitioning his throne about something. But when I come to the throne of God, the throne of Yahweh, in Jesus' name, I pray to the Father in Jesus' name. The word says, when I come, God wants me to come in faith. God wants me to come with my request, believing that it's already done. So when he said, you must come believing, he's saying you must come in faith. So what is faith? So if God wants us to come in faith, faith means that when I ask God to do something, I have assurance in him. Insurance in God. I have full confidence in God. Another terminology of faith is confidence. I have confidence in God. Listen, as long as the request is according to God's perfect will, according to God's will. Now, I'm asking for something that outside of his will, you already know. We already know better. It's not going to get answered. God don't do witchcraft prayers. He don't do witchcraft prayer. He do not answer witchcraft prayers, period. Now, if we are making a request before God, and it is God's perfect will, he said we must ask in faith. We must ask him in confidence that he will do it. We must have insurance in God, assurance in God's ability to do it. We must rely on God to do it. Having faith is having a firm trust in God or what has actual existence. Don't you know faith got actual existence? That when I go before God to the throne room of God, I am asking him. And when I ask God to do something in faith, I have stepped over into the realm of the supernatural. I have stepped over into a territory that I have 100% confidence that my God will provide, that my God will heal, that my God will deliver, that my God will supply. I have stepped into a realm that God will release the kingdom. Because now I'm operating by faith in him, not in me. I'm putting my faith, my trust in the Lord. So the kingdom of God shall manifest on earth, because there is no doubt. But it said when he acts, he must believe and not doubt, because a person who doubts is like a wave of the sea. They toss here and forth. Now, what is doubt? We already know doubt. The base root of doubt is fear. Fear. This is when we begin to question God. We begin to wonder. We become afraid. It's fear. When we doubt, we're afraid. What happened when Peter, As long as Peter's faith was in Jesus when he walked on water, how in the world can a human being walk on water? How, even if that's possible? Because when he initially stepped out in that boat, he stepped out in faith. He stepped out in the realm of the supernatural. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. That please God. What? He gonna believe me like that? Walk, Peter, walk. But begin when he began to focus on the wind blowing and everything else and got distracted, what began to happen? He began to lose faith in God and began to fear. Fear. Fear is one of the root things that can hinder our prayers from being answered. When we began to fear, we began to doubt, we began to wonder, we began to question God, we began to lack confidence in God. So we got to make sure when we make a request known to God, we are functioning by faith. We're functioning by faith. So doubt and unbelief is a hindrance to keep us from getting our prayers answered or hearing God's voice effectively. It says that man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. Now, God just told us, don't even think, Rasheda, you'll receive anything from me when I see that fear, when I see you doubting me, when I see you not functioning in the supernatural, when I see you're not relying and depending on my word. You're not standing in agreement with me. So don't think you're going to receive anything from me. Why? Because I am looking at the fruit of your heart. Your heart is dedicating to heaven. She don't believe. I'm going to say it like that. She functioned as an unbeliever. Heaven like the Godhead, Jesus like Holy Spirit. Father, you see Rasheda? You see what's in her heart? She functioned like them unbelievers. That woman should not think she's going to receive anything from us. We going to sit here until her faith get in order with the word. Do y'all hear me? We praying to God. And I'm guilty. Guilty. I'm guilty of all the other scriptures too. We just went over. Guilty. I've been guilty. Standing, requesting heaven to bag me up and doubting at the same time. Doubting. And God take me to the word. I need you to go to James 1:6, daughter through 8. And I'm going to tell you why I haven't answered you. I'm going to show you why your prayers have, the kingdom have not been released. Because you're not going to receive nothing from me because you double-minded. You unstable. You unstable. That's why I got to, I come in agreement to what is written. I come in agreement with my word. I come in agreement with the heavenly counsel. My word can't return to me void, Rasheda. I'm not a liar. It can't return void. I can't lie. So until your faith function in the realm of the supernatural, your request on hold, on hold. Are we getting this? Are we getting this? Are we getting this? Are we getting this? He said that man should not think he'll receive anything from the Lord. And I'm going to even tell y'all, we can be crying about stuff. Oh God. Oh God. He said, well, you know what? Until you believe me, until you come to line with what is written, what you want me to do? Where your faith? Where your faith? Where your faith? You got to function in the realm of faith. Faith unlocks miracles. Faith in God without faith is impossible to please him. Faith is substance of things what hope for, evidence. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. You don't even see it yet in the natural, but in the realm of the supernatural, it's already done. But faith has to unlock those particular things. So once you believe it, you receive it by faith, and God will manifest it in the earth. Whatever due season, due time, he say fit. So he said a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So when I like using myself. So when I am double-minded, God says, this is what he's saying. Okay, I see Rasheda down there. She, Rasheda in the courts. She's in the courts. You know, she got a request before you, Lord. She need this and that, 1, 2, 3 things done. And the Lord like, yeah, I see her heart though. Uh-huh. Yeah, she asking me. And part of her in her heart, she's still trying to fix it. She don't have enough faith that I can do that all by myself. I can take care of that. She got some little doubt there, some little worry there, some little stress right there. When she gonna really give it to me and let me work it? He said a double-minded man. So when I look down, I see two minds. I see two minds. I see two minds. I see one mind believing God, want to believe God, and I see another mind that's a whole lot of fear. So this person is double-minded. So when you got two minds, imagine being two heads, two minds, God said you are unstable. You are unstable in all you do. So what does it mean to be unstable? Unstable means you are always wandering in your purpose or your intent. You have lack of emotional control. This is a person that can also have wild moves, mood swings. You are emotionally unsettled in your mind. You are not solid and firm. You are unbalanced. It's an unbalanced mind. God wants us to have the mind of Christ. And even as, let me tell you this. Even if you go to God and you are making requests and your mind is double, because we all get there sometimes. We like be confused in the mind. Oh, God, 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 God. But in the midst of the prayer, begin to learn how to shift. Even if you start that way in prayer, learn how to shift. Get the Spirit of the Lord may say, hey, let's shift. Come out of your feelings. Come out of your emotions. Come out of that. I need you to shift. Get in my word. What does my word declare? I need you to move out of your mind into the mind of Christ. Do y'all hear me? He's saying shift into the mind of Christ. Get in my word. What does my blueprint say? Because God won't. The miracles unlocked, and it's going to take faith. You got to shift your mind out of your mind, out of your way of thinking. He says, my ways are not like your ways, Rasheda. My thoughts are not like your thoughts, said the Lord. I don't think like you. I don't think that low. I need you to shift. Get in my word. Don't you know the Bible? This word, this is God's mind. This is how God thinks right here. This is how he thinks. So if our mind is being doubled, get into the knowledge of heaven. This is the knowledge of heaven. This is like going to school right here. If we want to know how God think about a situation, get in the word. This is his mind. This is how he's thinking. This is also what let us know what is God's perfect will for us. It's in the word of God. Amen. I think we had enough for number four. Doubt and unbelief can hinder us from getting our prayers answered. So if we want our prayers answered, we got to have confidence in God and in his word. Amen. Let's go to number five. I want y'all to write this down. Write this one down. Number five, ways that can hinder us from hearing, getting our prayers answered or hearing God's voice effectively. Number five, too much focus on the demonic. Too much focus on demons. Too much focus. Let's go to Proverbs 11:27. Proverbs 11:27 NIV version. He said, he who seeks good finds goodwill. He who seeks good, seek good, you're going to find goodwill. Goodwill means you're going to find good things. You're going to find what's excellent. You're going to find good morals. You're going to find what's beneficial to you. You're going to find of good understanding. If you're seeking something good, what's the fruit of good? His goodness. You're going to find stuff that's good. Then the NIV version says, he who sees good find goodwill, but evil comes to him who searches for it. Evil comes to those who are searching for evil. If you're searching for evil, you're going to find it. So don't focus so much on evil. Don't focus so much on what this person is doing or what the devil is doing. Don't focus too much on that. Don't get your mind crowded on that. Set your mind on things above and not on things below. Now we do know, let's go back to the school of wisdom. We do know the Holy Ghost at times take us into the classroom that we will learn about the strategies of the kingdom of God or what's happening in the kingdom of darkness. Holy Spirit, take us into those classrooms to teach us and to equip us how to take down a python spirit, how to take down a spirit in a region of Jezebel or witchcraft or Ahab spirit, how to tear down demonic movements, this new age movement. We do know that Holy Spirit do take us to those classrooms to equip us in spiritual warfare, to equip us how to dethrone certain demons. But what the Holy Spirit also is trying to teach us, don't focus too much on the demonic. Make sure the Holy Spirit is opening up these doors to different classrooms, to different trainings, that he may train you that it don't be a trick of the enemy. Amen. Because a lot of times, I just through experience, I have kind of mentored and ministered to some people and trying to help them through some things and dealing with deliverance, and come to find out most of everything they saw was demons. They were always fearful. Woo, woo, woo. Just very, very fearful. Very, very. I mean, the enemy just was taking advantage of these vessels. So in that strategy, the Lord had to help me to tell the individual how to shift from that realm into the realm of heaven, because the enemy will try to wear us out, especially if the Holy Spirit has not opened up the door into certain different regions. And I'm gonna give you another example. I remember this was years ago. I was at this time in my walk with God, in my ministry with the Lord. I was functioning very, very strong, and still is today through the grace of God, very, very strong in deliverance and spiritual warfare ministry. Very, very strong. I had gotten a call from someone, and they was telling me, you need to go to, it was another city. go to another city back in my hometown because something had broke out there and a person was dealing with major mental battles, major mental issues that was very, very, it was just a lot that this person actually was dealing with. So they actually called me and say, hey, you need to go down there. We believe you go pray, whatever God use you, that person could get free. Keep in mind, I was functioning in deliverance, spiritual warfare in that time in my ministry, but I did not feel led to that assignment. So what I'm saying, word of wisdom, just because you are functioning in a degree of deliverance, warfare, you still got to be led by Holy Spirit. I was not at that time equipped enough, I can humbly say, equipped enough to function in that jurisdiction. I don't want to get too much into ranks and jurisdiction spirits. That's for a later teaching. Because you got to learn your rank in the kingdom and the territory, maybe I should use that word, the territory that Holy Spirit has led you to govern. I'll say it that way. So at that season in my life, I was not ready and I was not going to let man release me into a territory that Holy Spirit did not call me to govern. Amen. So I give God the glory. So I wanted to kind of throw that out because we was talking about don't focus too much on the demonic. Just make sure in everything that you do, you are spirit led. And now in my season, and because of some things I have now gone through dealing with mental illness and mental health, now over the last 3 years of my life, the Lord has equipped me in that area to a measure now that He has graced me now to go back and minister to other people in that arena. But then I wasn't equipped or ready for that. So I just want you to use wisdom. We don't want to get caught up in taking on battles that Holy Spirit. Remember, I told you earlier, He's within us. He's with us. He's our trainer. He's our teacher. He's supposed to be our God. Amen. So now let's go to number six. This is the last one, last key for today. I have several, but we're going to stop at six. Six. Top it again. We're learning how to remove hindrance that hinder us from hearing God's voice or that hinders our prayers from being answered. That hinder our prayers from being answered. The very last one we're going to talk about, which I think is very, very, very important. The very last one is coming from James 4 and 3 and Proverbs 21 and 2. James 4 and 3, Proverbs 21 and 2. One way that our prayers can be hindered is when we pray with wrong motives. When we pray with wrong motives. Not only we have, we know witches, we know warlocks, we know high priestess. I don't want to go too deep. We know they always pray with wrong motives. Always. That's their agenda. That's their nature. Because they work for the kingdom of darkness. That's their nature. And they do pray. They do pray. But they always pray with wrong motive. That's their agenda. That's who they work for. They got a leader that they submit to. But now I'm talking to the church. We can pray with wrong motives. Now, wrong motives, James 4 and 3. It says, when you ask, you do not receive. The word says, because you ask with wrong motives, period. that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. Now let's talk about this, because earlier we was talking about using scriptures for one thing. Say, okay, I confess my sin, God will forgive me, but your heart, your motive, the motive of our heart was to keep on sinning. So this scripture also helped backstab the motive of the heart. So when we ask God for something, we don't receive because we ask with the wrong motive. Okay, what are motives? Your motive could be good and your motive can be evil. Your motive can be good and your motive can be bad. Your motive could be like Christ and your motive could be for selfish reason. So hidden motives deals with self. Hidden motives deals with the flesh, what the flesh wants. Hidden motives can also deal with a evil spirit that could be at work, that making the request through a individual. So when you ask, God said you will not receive it because you are asking with your motive not being like me. That's not the right motive for wanting that. That's not the right motive for desiring that. That's not the right motive. Your heart is full with wrong motives. No, I will not answer that request. You will not get it from the Lord. You will not get it from the Lord. And that's why too, some people can tap into all type of demonic type praying, and some does not know they're doing it. Some do not know they're doing it. They tap into all type of demonic praying. And some believers, they believe in going to do tarot card reading. They believe in horoscope reading. They believe in dialing the psychic line. You all, that's not of God. That's not of God. And you're tapping into a realm where you are opening up doors that you're probably not even equipped to deal with in the realm of the spirit. You're giving the enemy legal ground. Let me not go too much into spiritual warfare, but make sure whatever you do, you're not asking with wrong motive. Now, Proverbs 21 and 2 says, all a man ways seem right to him, but the Lord weighs the heart. All a man ways seem right to him, but the Lord weighs the heart. All my ways can seem right to me, but God saying, I'm putting your heart on my weight, on a weight in heaven. And I'm weighing your heart, Rasheda. I'm judging your heart. What you may be doing may seem right to you, but I'm looking at the condition of your heart. I got your heart on my weight in heaven, and I'm weighing your heart. I am looking at the inner self. I'm looking at the motive. I'm looking at the condition of your heart, of why you are making such a request like that. We can do and say the right things, but what's the condition of the heart? What's the motive of the heart? Why you are requesting that? And God said, I already know the condition of your heart. So we must make sure that when we give a request to the Father, that our motive is right before God. That our motive is right before God. God, purify my heart. God created me a clean heart. God know even when we quote and pray that scripture, he's weighing the heart. Is it coming from a real place? Is that an authentic prayer? Is that an authentic prayer? praise? Or is I'm trying to pray that way to impress the people? Because y'all, I hate false humility. Oh, I hate it. Keep it. Just stop. The false humility. Pretending to be humble. To pretending to act all humble before men. No, guys. Wrong motive is wrong motive. So we want to make sure our prayers are answered because he weighs the heart. He weighs everything we do. He don't want us to be religious about it. He don't want us to just be quoting scriptures and we have no desire on the inside with the help of the Holy Spirit to walk in that truth. To sum it all up. Is our heart, how is the condition of our heart when we make requests to our God in Jesus' name? The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit know. Don't y'all know this is how the Holy Spirit checked me? The Holy Spirit lives in me. Holy Spirit lives in me. Before I'm about to release it out of my mouth, he be green. Hey, hey, hey. Okay, God. And he's given me an opportunity. Come in alignment. Come in alignment. Some people say things to people with wrong motive. They true intent when the Lord weigh their heart is to tear the other person down. That's why we need the Holy Spirit help. Holy Spirit has to correct us. Holy Spirit has to train us. Holy Spirit has to teach us. Holy Spirit comes in and help purify us. So we need Holy Spirit's help to walk out a lifestyle of holiness. Become one with the Holy Ghost. Become in alignment to practice following the voice of God, yielding to God. And we know the blood of Jesus has already cleansed us. The blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. But God himself knows when we will try to treat the blood like it's unholy and trample in it. He knows. And he knows when we cannot use those scriptures to justify our voluntarily sinning, our willfully sinning, as we read in Hebrews 10. In 26, there's a difference in godly sorrow. In godly sorrow in someone that's just being very religious with scripture and has no desire to walk in its truth. I hope that this teaching today has blessed you. And I do apologize that I did move up the time up today. Started today at 12:30 noon time, and it's now around 2:15-ish that we will be ending. Normally the school will be at 2 p.m. every other Sunday. So I really hope, guys, that you took notes, that you have taken notes and you got the 6 steps on how to remove hindrances that keep you from hearing God's voice, and also that hinder you from getting your prayers answered. That was 6 points that was put out. I have given out the scriptures for those 6 points. I want you to take some time, study the scripture. Not only study, remember, I don't study scripture just to quote it back to you, trying to impress you, but I study the scripture for myself, guys, so I can walk in the scripture. I got to walk in the truth. I'm studying the scripture so I can obey it. See, we got to cooperate with Holy Spirit. We can't put everything on Holy Spirit to do. He's here to help us, but God has given us a free will. Because you know we was in the world. We ain't nobody help us to sin, did we? We sinned. We went out there and did what we did. We may have influences from evil spirits, but we had to what? Yield to the evil spirits. Same way. In the kingdom of God, we have to yield to the Holy Spirit. So guys, we are without excuse. I'm without excuse. So I study scripture so I can apply it. So I won't be a one making, using 1 John 1:9. Well, I confess my sin. God forgave me. He purified me from all unrighteousness. But when God weighed my heart, that's all I did. Spoke some out of my mouth. But my heart was never convicted and changed. So this spirit can carry weight in the nostrils of heaven. Do y'all hear me? We want it to carry weight in the nostrils of heaven. That when the enemy see me confessing and repenting, he already know. He got to loose his hold. She mean business. She about to tear up my kingdom. She is in right standing with the word. Because God's word ain't going to return to him void. We want to be a testimony as we walk this earth, saint, that when God look down, he see the word at work. He see us living the word. He see us functioning like Christ. So I study scripture, guys. I studied this scripture. I studied this today. Not just so I can just teach you. That was part of it. That was part of it. But I study it so I could obey it and apply it to my life. It was not just for God, you all. My role in the earth, part of it, is not only a teacher. But he's calling me to live holy. My role in life is not only an intercessor, not only a prophetess, but he's calling me to live holy. See, we got people that has a lot of guilt. We got gifts. Gifts and calling comes without repentance. We got to stop making excuses. And we got to begin to train ourselves. Okay, that person is very anointed to teach God's word. But the fruit that's pointed off the tree is nothing of the Holy Ghost. It's nothing of the Holy Spirit. So they gifted. And they don't even obey God's word. We don't want to be just gifted and we're not obeying and applying the word. Yes, we're going to make mistakes. Yes, we're going to miss the mark. But are you practicing obeying the word, yielding to Holy Spirit, yielding to the word of God? Because he ain't going to ask us to do nothing we can't do. Or are you going to continue practice living as a sinner? Call it like it is. You're living as a sinner. Call it like it is. You're not living as the word. So I pray that this has blessed you guys. Again, I'm going to be back in here this week studying this word so I can continue to apply it. So I can continue to walk in it. That I can be evidence that Holy Ghost lives in me. Because I want my prayers to be answered. And I want God to remove every hindrance. And I welcome the Holy Spirit. So I ask you guys to tune in the following Sunday for the next School of Intercession. And those that comes to the building for the School of Intercession training, remember we always do reviews and I give you tests. And I'm going to see if you have listened and that you have learned the information, because you will get quizzed and tested. And remember, the quiz and tests is to see have you retained this. And also remember, we're going to have to apply the word. We just don't want to get full of knowledge and we're not applying it. Before I get off, I want to tell you about the next service, but give me about 2 minutes, probably seconds. I'm about to go in the living room and get the card to show you guys. One moment before I get off. Okay, guys. This Sunday, October the 4th. Let's begin. So, chat. October the 4th at 2 p.m. Central, we will be in the building and we will have what I believe the Lord called it, a revivalist evangelistic service. And the mission, because I believe what God calls the body of Christ to do, he give you his assignments. So I call this an assignment. I look at what the Lord has put on my husband and I to do, that it is an assignment from heaven, and we need to seek him for the orders and how to govern in the land and how to. So we're not a religious ministry. We are a kingdom ministry called and sent by the Lord. So we'll be having a revival evangelist service, and it is geared toward teens, young adults, the millennium. But of course, anyone can come out. It's at 2 p.m. That next Sunday, October 4th, we'll be wearing spiritual t-shirts. So we'll be wearing spiritual t-shirt and jeans or whatever. If you want to wear a skirt, it's totally fine. Or whatever type of pants you would like to wear, dress pants, is totally fine. But we'll be wearing spiritual t-shirts. I have already placed the order for the group spiritual t-shirt that's called Prayer Revivalist. I have already placed that order, but you can go to any store and get you a spiritual t-shirt if the Lord leads you to come. And remember, I always says, if the Lord leads you, because I believe people need to be where God leads them. Every ministry is not catered for every person. But I believe that everyone needs to be where God leads you. Also, they'll be at 2 p.m. We will have a guest praise team ministry, Dwelling Place International Church. They will be there. Apostle Ken Tony, his church will come forth and they will lead us into praise and worship. I want you all to share. Any young adult that the Lord leads you to share this with, that they can come out Sunday. Come out Sunday at 2 p.m. Our focus will be on salvation, rededication, repentance. Some people don't know the process of salvation. Some people make it too difficult, and some people make it, you just do this. But we're going to show them based on scripture. What is salvation? You know, how to repent, how to walk in repentance. Not just tell them, but teach how to walk into repentance. But it's going to be more of a praise, prayer, and a little teaching service to pull in the lost sheep. So come out, bring your young children. If the Lord leads you, God leading you to pray for us, keep us in prayer. But I have these cards. We will also be going out to pass out these cards Saturday, October the 3rd at 3 p.m. at the building where we have services. We will be out October the 3rd at 3 p.m. at 6341 Highway 51 North, Horn Lake, Mississippi. We'll just meet in front of the building. We will give strategy and how we will go out and give out these cards. And if we'll give out these cards in that particular community. And we're just going to trust God. We're going to have faith that God is going to send the wind. So we're not, we just learn about it. We're moving out doubt. And all of us go through 1 through 6 because we want our prayers answered. Amen. So God bless you. I thank you all so much. Can you say the address again? Okay. The address is 6341 Highway 51 North. 6341 Highway 51 North, Horn Lake, Mississippi, 38637. 38637. Also, It is on the School of Intercession Global Ministry Facebook page, the address as well. If you have any questions, you can always inbox me, and I get your questions answered. And I think that is all at the moment. Excuse me. I think that's all at the moment that I can think of. So again, those that the Lord is leading to the service, I see you October the 4th. The following week, we'll be back online. I will not be at the building. I'll be back online doing another teaching on how to hear from God clearly for. How to hear from God clearly for. I will also combine the other two teachings that some of you guys did miss, how to hear from God clearly. I will combine that, and that will be up on the YouTube channel. Again, thank you guys so much for tuning in. I ask that you share this broadcast teaching, and I truly believe it will be a blessing to the body of Christ, that we will learn how to remove every hindrance and to remove every unclean spirit, that our prayers can truly be powerful and effective in the earth. And I bless God for each of you. Remember, we do not want a form of godliness and deny the power of God. We want to be changed. We want to be changed. We want to function in the supernatural. And we don't want to use scriptures, being religious, saying I did this and your lifestyle is still not according to the word. So that's how you can judge yourself. And that's how I can judge myself, according to the word. God bless you. You all have a wonderful day.